This
Okay, good
conference
evening.
will now be recorded.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you all for joining us. And of course, thank you especially to Rav Kalman Samuels, who's joining us at 6:30 a.m. Israel time to share with us about Shalva. I'm going to mute all just for a moment. Okay, Shalva, as we'll hear, is an amazing organization in Israel that helps literally thousands of people every day. And it helps those who are the most vulnerable amongst us, which includes the disabled, and as we'll hear from Kalman, and their families and all that they go through. So it really is a privilege. Natalie, on her trips to Israel, brought her women to the Shalva Center, and they were all blown away by it. So what I'm going to do first is show a 90-second clip about Shalva. And in doing that, I'm going to, in order to help the smooth showing of the video, I'm going to turn off everyone's cameras. Okay, so your cameras are going to be turned off. And that will then enable us to see this video.
There's magic in this place.
What is so beautiful about Shalva is that they put the family and the child first.
Every child with special needs needs a mother, a father, and Shalva.
טל כבר 14 שנה בשלווה, 4 שנים בלהקת שלווה, טל כבר שנה עובד בבית קפה.
שלווה בעצם עזרו לפקוח את העיניים ולהבין, יש לי ילדה מהממת, יפה, מדהימה, ויש לה תסמונת דאון.
When a visitor leaves the center after a tour, he becomes an ambassador for children with disabilities, an ambassador of acceptance of those who are different.
Okay, everybody. And let me unmute all so Kalman Samuels can also. There we go. Just one second. Okay. And let me make Kalman a presenter. Okay, Kalman, do we see you?
He has to just put his camera.
Kalman, please put your camera on.
My camera's on.
Okay, one second.
Go to options.
I still show this. Okay, Kalman. Your camera should be able to go on.
Hold on, bear with me. Share my webcam?
No, you don't need that. Oh, yes, perfect. Perfect. Kalman, I think you're sharing your screen, so you could stop that.
Hold on. How in the world do I do 1 minute? How do I do that, Rabbi? I appreciate that, but I don't know how to get it off here. It's not Zoom. Anyone can tell me how to stop?
There's like three buttons, mic, camera, and screen.
I just took myself off altogether. Correct? Oh my.
Dismiss comments.
Share the webcam?
Just your web, no, they'll turn it off. Okay, Kalman, towards the bottom, it should say mic, camera, screen, and leave.
Mic, camera, screen.
Great, hit screen. There we go. Perfect.
Okay. Thank you very much, Rabbi.
Okay, so once again, I'd like to present Kalman Samuels. He's only going to be able to share a certain part of his story. I have the book, Dreams Never Dreamed, which is an incredible book that was actually gripping, available on Amazon, and I was able to read the whole story and subsequently make many other connections that I and Kalman had that we discovered during our phone conversation. But it really is an amazing journey. And one of the things that I often discuss in classes is that how life is a journey, and the things that come our way are given to us in order that we can grow from them and help others through them. And keep that in mind as we hear from Kalman, how we need to take our experiences and our challenges and make sure that we become greater from it, by it, and that the world also improves as a result. So without further ado, let me present to you Kalman Samuels, the founder of Shalva Organization.
Thank you, Rabbi. It's a great privilege to be with you, with your community. And Shalva is a fascinating story, and I think the best way to understand it is to go a little bit back in time. It began 30 years ago, but I'm going to go a little bit further back because I too am a West Coast boy, born and raised in Vancouver, Canada, a child of the 60s, and a non-religious family, non-observant, and that I grew up having a lot of opportunities. My father was a lawyer and had a wonderful education, public high schools, and I had a lot of good things available to me as I left high school at the age of 17, including basketball scholarships, university, and several academic scholarships. And my goal in university was, in my undergraduate years, to study and master Western civilization. I thought to be an academic in that field. My father hoped I'd be a lawyer, but I don't know if that would have happened. And I had a professor who used to say to us that all the young people in those days, I'm talking about 1970, 69, 70, they were going to India, as I'm sure they still do, to China. And he said that they're living in a vacuum, that they really have no tools with which to examine and understand a foreign culture because they don't even know their own. And he says, if you want to have the ability to assess another culture, then you must study our culture, Western civilization, and know who you are. And of course, I took that very much to heart. When I was on my way to France to study on my second year of university, my mother asked me to visit Israel for 2 weeks en route. I said, sorry, Mom, but Israel is an apartheid state and I'm not about to visit Israel. People have the sense that this concept of an apartheid state came on in the 80s. It was there on University of British Columbia campus in 1970. Naturally, my mother had her way, and I visited Israel, and I did all the things that a typical visitor of my age would do. I slept on the beach in Eilat. I went up to a kibbutz to work the fields for a few days in the north. of course, the wall, Kotel, and the museums, etc. Those 2 weeks made me realize that, you know what, my Sunday school education at the synagogue in Vancouver was not quite all that I thought it was. And there's much more to Israel than I could ever have imagined. And I decided to take the summer and figure it out. So I stayed and I studied and I met people. And by the end of the summer, I realized that, guess what? It's going to take a little bit longer than I thought to figure this out. So I'm going to take a year and then I'll have an opportunity to really have a handle on this and go forward. In the course of that summer, the thing that made me make that decision was that I met an interesting rabbi from Australia. And in the course of conversation, he asked me different questions and I had no clue what he was talking about. And he said to me that, you know, you really don't have any depth of understanding about your own Judaism. And why are you going to study someone else's culture, Western civilization, when you don't even know your own primary culture, Judaism? And that hit me very strongly because of the thought process I had had. And I said, you know what, he's right. So I dedicated a year. By the end of that year, I was quite clear to me that what I really wanted to do was, if I was ever going to be an academic, it would be in the Jewish studies area. And I slowly became religious, studied, ultimately in 1977, took out a very serious rabbinical ordination. In the interim, I met my wife, Malki, we married, and we began having our own family. We had a beautiful daughter, we had a beautiful son named Yossi, we have. And Malki took Yossi to a public health center at the age of 11 months to give him one of his routine vaccinations. And unbeknownst to us and unbeknownst to the public at large, the Ministry of Health had been having severe problems with two batches, faulty batches of that vaccine. And Yossi was one of the hundreds who were injured. He became blind, deaf, and very hyperactive. And it wasn't in one moment, boom, he's blind, he's deaf. It was a process. And it was a very troubling, tedious process that literally flipped our young lives on its head. Add to that the fact that we couldn't get medical information clearly because no one was talking. So it so happens my uncle was the head of a major hospital in New York for orthopedics. And he said, come out to New York and I'll put you in contact with some serious people who will talk to you. We did that and we learned very quickly that his optic nerve was atrophied. He'll never see again. His hearing was damaged. A year and a half later, he was deaf. And we, rather than going home as planned after 3 weeks, stayed. I went into the computer field and spent the next two decades in that field. And life was very, very tough. Everything was plastic. Additional children were born. We decided that if we're going to have a family, we're going to have it. And we did. And occasionally there were well-meaning visitors to my wife, usually people who were her former teachers in Israel. And one of them came to visit her. She was in New York for her own, you know, personal reasons. And at the end of the conversation, she said to Malki, you know, Malki, it's very nice of you that you, you know, want to keep this child at home, etc. But it's really not a normal life. And it's not fair to your husband nor to your other children that this child controls everything every minute of the day. And that night, Malki cried and said, God, I'm never taking Yossi out of the house. It's my gift from you. But I do promise you this, that if you ever decide to help our Yossi, I'm going to dedicate my life to helping other mothers with their children with disabilities that I know are crying along with me, for their children. Fast forward, we came back to Israel with 5 years later, altogether 5 years later. We, excuse me, we I continued in the computer field. We enrolled Yossi in the school for the deaf in Jerusalem, where we lived. And miracle of miracle, at the age of 8, a teacher who was deaf herself put one palm on a table. In the other palm, she spelled 5 symbols for 5 Hebrew letters. And she spelled Shin, Vav, Lamed, Chet, Nun, the word Shulchan or table. And she did this for days on end. And at some moment, Yossi smiled from ear to ear. And she had the smarts to understand that he had just had what we call his Helen Keller moment. He had just had his breakthrough to communication. She went ballistic. We had no idea what she was talking about, that his life had forever changed. And indeed it did. He learned the 22 letters, which meant we could now spell anything to him. He slowly learned words. I remember when he had 10, and when he had 50, and when he had 100. And then an extraordinary young speech therapist, on the basis of her work, crawled into his mouth for 2 years, being bitten initially, and taught him how to speak Hebrew synthetically. How do you teach someone who doesn't hear, doesn't see, the whole being is locked, and yet she penetrated and taught him how to speak Hebrew synthetically. So now we had a child who not only we could spell to and could spell back, but he could also talk. And it turned out Yossi is a genius. He has never stopped learning. And Malki turned to me and said, it's payback time. I made a promise. I need your help to deliver. Yossi by this time had become known as the Helen Keller of Israel. There was a lot of media about him. And Malki shared her dream of what she wanted to do. And I realized quickly that without funding, it's never going to happen. And I began looking for someone somewhere who might buy into her dream. No one buys into someone's dreams very quickly when they're not known. And it took quite a few years. In 1990, I was in my hometown, Vancouver, and an extraordinary family named the Diamonds, who knew me well, got up to talking, and I shared Malki's dream. And they said they would get us started, and they did. We rented a duplex, a garden duplex in Jerusalem. Malki started running one after-school program from 1 to 6, in which children with disabilities of all kinds and from all parts of the population would come after the government-paid school for special ed. Some of them started at 1 at a young age, and it was staggered throughout the day in terms of when they arrived. And they had an amazing time. They had fun. They had group therapy. They had music therapy, etc. They had a hot meal that Malki prepared with her 2 staff and some volunteers, and were bused home. Malki bused them home at 6 o'clock, and they got home 6:15, 6:20. And what that meant was that the 2 parents could work. It meant that the siblings could come home and do homework with mommy and daddy. And when the child did arrive home, the family was ready and waiting to give him or her the love the child needs and live a typical quality life. The whole paradigm had suddenly been changed. It was 5 days a week. Malki realized that to give an aspirin for a serious, it's good for a headache, but for a more serious, complex problem, it's not going to help. And therefore, she realized that, you know, somehow this is what is needed. Now, we were accused in the early days by government officers of the Ministry of Education of spoiling the parents. And I said, you know, it's amazing, and I'm so happy that you have no clue what you're talking about. You're clearly not a parent of a child with a disability, because even when the child comes home at 6:15, the family has enormous amounts to do. And if we can alleviate the 200 pounds on their shoulders and enable them to function, not only they will benefit, but their child will benefit. And the therapy we do with that child will be effective. If with the family, if the mother is not on her feet, there's very little that can be done to help that child long term. What we didn't expect was that people would be banging on our doors and saying that I have a child, I have a nephew, I have a neighbor's child, the family's falling apart, you must take the child in. And we did. First come, first serve, never payment. The only if someone wanted to help, they could certainly donate, but we would not take in a child based on a family's ability to pay. And because we took first come, first serve, the children we served then and today represent the entire spectrum of the Israeli population, Jewish and non-Jewish. So Shalva began to grow and Malki began to create programs around the clock. She, after that, created an amazing overnight respite program that differs from any other program in this vein, that rather than helping the child 4 or 5 days at the end of the year or some point when the family's falling apart, or periodically, it was once a week, one night a week for each family every week. And given the fact that I had no government funding of any kind for the first 11 years and I was still working in the computer field, I said to her, Malki, why do you need every week? It costs a fortune. What's wrong with once a month? And she said in her typical manner, because that's what's needed. Once a week makes the difference and enables people to have a slice in time and function. Once a month is nice, but it's not going to do what I want it to do. And she was so right. It makes a complete difference in the life of such families. And if there's one program of the many programs that Shalva operates that I would have loved to have had when Yossi was young, it would definitely be that program to give a break. And then it works on Shavuot, so it's also weekends, and it is just an extraordinary. Now, again, every family has one night a week. After that, I came home one day from my computers and I found her crying and I said, what did I do now? And she said, for a change, nothing. Just I can't live with myself. I said, why can't you live with yourself? She says, because we're not using the center. We had by this time built a beautiful center of our own. And I can't, I need a program for mothers who just gave birth to children with disabilities. And they are struggling. And I know that if the program that I want to put together will put them back on their feet. What was the program? She wanted to call it Me and My Mummy, which she did. And it was a program where, again, each day of the week in Israel, Sunday through Thursday, a group of mothers who just gave birth to a child with disability come to the center. They get 5 different therapies. We're talking about speech and occupational and physical, etc. But not just to get therapy, but to be taught by our staff how to do it themselves at home, so that they go home and they have those basic skills to be empowered to help themselves. The mothers swam in our beautiful therapy pool, and miracles happened in that pool. And they have coffee and cake together. They suddenly gain a sense of community. And very quickly, these mothers, the program goes for 1.5 years, from birth to 1.5. And these mothers literally got back on their feet. In many cases, fathers joined them and were there as part of the program. They were certainly welcome. And much has been written about this program in the academic literature. And the key is the fact that very early on, mothers and fathers get hope that I'm not alone. There is somebody there who's going to be there for us. And as it developed, we developed later daycare programs for 1 to 3 year olds, preschools for 4 to 6 year olds. So now we were sitting with programs literally around the clock. The center had 400 people waiting to get in. The government was now giving me a pittance of funding. And they came to me in 2005 and said, would you build a much larger center if we give you a big piece of land? And quite frankly, I didn't believe a word of it. But they showed me the land, and it was no less than 7 acres in the heart of Jerusalem, near the Sheher Tzedek Medical Center, 500 yards from Mount Herzl. And I brought Malki to see this very hilly, difficult piece of land. And we both said, it's not a crime to fail, but it would be criminal not to make the effort to try and take advantage of this literally once in a lifetime opportunity for this population. So we did, we undertook to do it, not knowing where we'd get money. We struggled as it was where we were. And miracle of miracle, in 2016, the building was completed. It took over 10 years, not because it took us that long, but because a very powerful neighbor, a very old hotel above us, and decided they didn't want us there. And they dragged us through 10 different courts over 10 years. And it was very much David against Goliath. We didn't think we would ever get past it to get our building permit because of these people. But again, we did. So the building you saw in the early video, it is the largest center in the world for people with disabilities. It's 220,000 square feet. It is certainly the most aesthetic and advanced. And we serve today 2,000 people a week from birth to adulthood. When I say today, I mean in non-COVID times. Some of our programs in the pools are not active today because of COVID. And therefore, you know, we're serving almost capacity, about 1,000 a day. But clearly, you know, like everybody else, the COVID has hit us as well. And we're open and we are functioning in an amazing, amazing way in spite of those problems. Shalva has become what we call a center of excellence. People from all over the world visit. We had 150,000 visitors in 2019. We have what's called the Shalva Institute that we set up during this year of COVID because everything is online, in which we are sharing what we've always done, but now it's become much more structured. And the interest is phenomenal, whether that be a center in Siberia, whether that be medical experts in Argentina, whether that be today the United Arab Emirates or Bahrain, they're all interested and we're there sharing and developing exciting new relationships. One of the programs that came out of the Shalva band is, excuse me, out of the Shalva music program is the Shalva band. Now, it's an interesting program because it's become very famous, but for us, it really is just one more program in which we are there to try and maximize the potential of every child. And again, those child's disabilities run the gamut from everything that is cognitive and physical. The calling card to Shalva has always been a cognitive disability. But with that, we know often comes severe physical disabilities. If a child is physically disabled but cognitively intact, then you can't be everything for everybody, and the program wouldn't work for that child because of the community we serve. But the music program began almost from inception. I had a music therapist at all times. And in 2005, a young man walked into my little office at the old childhood center and said to me, hi. He sat down and he introduced himself and he said he wants to work at Shalva as a music therapist. I told him that, thank you very much, but I have one, I don't need another one. And he said, yes, but I'll do something more for you. I said, well, what will you do? He says, I'll build you a band. I said, tell me more about it. He told me about himself. He had been injured in a Duv Divan, you may know it as Fauda, a failed raid in which he was gravely injured. He spent over a year in hospital, had just been out a couple of months and wanted to go back to his first love, music. And I said to him, Shai, you know what? How long is it going to take you? He says, a year. I said, let's go for it. And we did. And it started very small with tweezers, picking out one little child with Down syndrome, another child with something else, and training them more than just music, but trying to get them together and play together. And it developed. It developed from in-house shows. It then became out-of-house shows for different gatherings for people with disabilities. And it developed into something that they were standalone, and they made an international tour. And they were hosted by Google, something called Ambassadors of Change for an hour, a recorded program on Google. And Israel's basically America Has Talent. It's called Rising Star in Israel. Is a very, very big musical competition here, the winner of which represents the country in Eurovision. Eurovision is something not always known to Americans. It's the largest musical contest in the world. 200 million people from 42 European countries and Australia compete. And our band was invited to audition. they auditioned, they loved them, and they began to compete. And we had hoped that maybe they would win one session. As it turned out, they knocked out the competition. They never lost. The only competitor not to lose. They got to the finals, became a household name in Israel. And we learned that from Eurovision that rather than just appearing on Saturday night after Shabbat, they would have to do a complete dress rehearsal on Friday night. And the minister of whatever it was here in Israel of culture, you know, wrote very, very big letters to Eurovision that this is unfair, et cetera, et cetera. But bottom line is they couldn't change their structure. And four of our band members are religious. They got together and they decided that we came in as a family, we're leaving as a family, and they respectfully withdrew. It made huge waves in Israel. I mean, if you Google Shalva band, you know, Sabbath or Shabbat, it's hysterical to see how many articles were written, and in English is a minor part of what was done on the Hebrew media. And Eurovision turned around because of the way we said goodbye. We never mentioned the word Shabbat. We respectfully withdrew. They turned around and they invited the band to perform as guest artists at Eurovision, which was held in Israel because the year previous, Netta, who you may have known or heard of, won the competition. And therefore, the competition this last year was going to be held in Israel. They sang a song called A Million Dreams and from the Greatest Showman, and they literally took Europe by storm. Major, major newspapers and media outlets in Europe said that these are without a doubt the winners of Eurovision. The BBC had the most amazing, effusing things to say, and I got emails from others to say, Kalman, you've done it. The BBC finally said something nice about Israel. So in a few moments, we will hear that song. We'll close with that. But I want to just update you where Yossi is today. Yossi is 43. He cannot see. He can't hear. Has not been able to walk for the last 24 years. That also left him, and that was a killer that he was no longer mobile. He walked a little bit awkwardly, but he walked on his own. And he has never given up. And he's the great realizer of his own dreams. He wanted to meet the President of the United States. Someone walked into Shalva one day, and it turned out I shared with Yossi that he was scheduled to be the next ambassador, American ambassador of a European country. Yossi got excited, told me to tell him that he wants to meet the president, and he asks him to make it happen. The man took a step back and said, tell your son, I will do everything I can to make that happen. A year later, Yossi was hosted by President Bush in 2007 in the White House. He wanted to meet the British Prime Minister. Someone arranged that. Yossi realized that his sense of smell was very much like a bloodhound. When the kids were small and one of them opened up a Coke in the next room, Yossi would start yelling, I want a Coke too. And we also realized that the two things that really work with smell in many ways are fragrances or wine tasting, because we know when we have a cold, we don't smell. So Yossi was trained by Israel's premier sommelier, the champion of 2006, I think, a young Frenchman. And for 2 years, he trained Yossi all about wine. Yossi was enormously successful. Today, Yossi has put out two of his own wines. And wouldn't you know, the name of the wine is called Handshake. And it has Braille on the wine. It is widely received. It was on sale in the leading duty-free shop in the airport until, of course, the airport and duty-free closed down. Yossi loves to ride horses. He had dreams of riding elephants, and we couldn't quite figure out how to do that. And one day, Malki received an email from one of the hundreds and hundreds of dear friends of Yossi. And he said, I'm in Thailand. I'm here for another 3 weeks. There are elephants. Please send me Yossi immediately. He then contacted a mutual friend living in Tel Aviv who also loved Yossi. And this young man, in spite of the fact his firstborn son his wife was 5 months pregnant, he immediately said, Malki, I'm in. And a couple of days later, she had them off to Thailand. When I say she, I had been in New York and I returned the day Yossi flew to Thailand. A couple of days after that, I was in the old center and I was hosting three American congressmen. And I told my secretary, look, I'm sitting with them a little bit in the guest room and then I'll give them a tour. Please make sure that nobody bothers us. A couple of minutes later, wouldn't you know, a knock on the door. I opened the door and there she was. I looked at her to say, really? And she very emotionally said, for God's sake, in Hebrew, for God's sakes, look at your email. I excused myself, looked at the email, and there was a photo of Yossi on the elephant with his two buddies, and Yossi smiling from ear to ear. I broke down and I shared with the congressman the background. And I said that, you know, as we grow older, I sort of find that we stop dreaming. Yossi has every reason not to dream, doesn't hear, doesn't see, he can't walk, but that's never stopped him from dreaming new dreams. In fact, I lived a life in many ways, like the title of my book, Dreams Never Dreamed, that as a secular kid in Vancouver, Canada, never did I dream or could I dream of speaking to you today as a rabbi from Jerusalem. When Yossi was injured, Malki and I could never have dreamed that Yossi would one day be able to communicate with us. And out of that communication, we could never have dreamed that Shalva would come out of it and come to where it has come today. So if I may make a single request from you, please, we all have dreams, young, middle, a little bit beyond middle. Don't give up on your dreams. Don't let anybody talk you out of them. A little bit of reality helps, but on the other hand, a dream is never quite reality. Go for it, and may God help all of us realize our dreams. Thank you so very much.
Thank you very much, Kalman. Thank you, thank you. We're going to have some questions and answers that we could pose to Kalman. But first, I'd like to show the video of the Shalva band at Eurovision. Like Kalman said, we're 200 million people watching one of the biggest stages of the world. Thank you. I wonder if there are any other, if there are any dry eyes out there. Kalman, come back on, please.
I see I'm unmuted.
Yeah.
Do I hit? Here we go.
Okay, beautiful. Wow, that's actually overwhelming. Kalman, one of the stories that you started to tell, but that really made an impression upon me when I read the book, was the story you mentioned that the woman had come to advise Malki that you need to institutionalize Yossi for the sake of the family, for the sake, and Malki said, absolutely not, we won't consider it. But then in the book, you told the story at his bar mitzvah. Could you share that with us? Please.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's fascinating you ask me, Rabbi. Thank you. Some years later, back in Jerusalem, Yossi was 13, and we had an amazing, extraordinary bar mitzvah for him. And he went up to the Torah. He made the blessings. Actually, I said them with him as well after him, so that, you know, those who wanted to make sure they heard from someone who was obligated in the Torah, since he didn't hear, they got what they needed too. But on Saturday night, we had an extraordinary party, and my parents came in from Vancouver, and there was singing and there was dancing, and Yossi was on people's shoulders, and it was absolutely everything anybody could possibly want from a bar mitzvah celebration for their child. And in the corner, I caught a sort of a diminutive little figure dressed in dark clothing. And I could see that she was crying. As we would say, she's bawling. And I suddenly realized that this was the very wonderful educator who many years before had told Malki, you must take Yossi out of the house. So there she was in full recognition that, you know what, not everything has to be perfect as you see it in your world. It's perfect as we see it in our world. And it was a very, very telling and moving moment for me.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, Kalman. I'd like to open up. Anybody else like to ask any questions? Please unmute yourselves. You could light up your cameras. Let's see some faces instead of just some letters. And please, any of you have any questions for Kalman, please ask away.
I'll ask you a question. What role does your wife play? I know I see you a lot in, you know, even in the audience, when Shalva was playing, I think for the contest in Israel. I saw you. Is your wife more visible? I mean, I don't know that I've really seen her. So what role does she play? I'm sure she is the power behind everything.
Nothing personal.
Nothing personal, but.
Malki is absolutely the visionary, the power. She built it. She built our first center with her own hands, with one Mohammed that we knew, who was an electrician we knew. We didn't have money for too many people. She built the building out of the mountainside. We bought a shell. The new center that we built, she designed with great architects, but they had no idea where to place things. And the interiors of that center, which are absolutely blow people away, every piece, every tile, every color is hers. And Malki is always below the radar by choice. She will never, you know, willingly appear in public. She's extraordinarily personable. People who meet her are enchanted. But she says, you know, I'm just really not interested in being in the public light. And she's not. Even in my book, I was advised I have to put in some pictures in the back. So the editor had me bring him a lot of pictures and chose pictures. And one of them, of course, was Malki and myself. And Malki vetoed that. And I said, you know, Malki, you can't not be in the book in a picture. And her words were, as always, you'll manage. And we manage. That's what it is. So Malki is no definitive role. She's the person who is still, actually, we have, thank God, today 450 employees. We have a budget of $20 million. The government gives us 38%. Social activities, we have the Shalva Cafe at Shalva, which is the finest Italian restaurant, or one of the finest Italian restaurants in Jerusalem. And it was 85,000 people ate there in 2019. So it brings in the public and inclusion. Everything we do in all of our programs is inclusive. I know I forgot to mention that, but it's like a given today, but we do it to an extraordinary way. And in the cafe, we have, of course, it's a social cafe where several of the employees are people with disabilities, but people flock to the cafe for the food. And Malki is involved with everything there, but she's not involved on doing the budget. We have fabulous professionals running every division. So she doesn't have to be there. She needed to be there in the early days. But at the end of the day, she's there without, again, having a defined role, not a defined title. But she is the mother of Shalva.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Please unmute yourselves. Don't be so bashful. Come on. Yes, Jill, good to see you.
Yeah, I was going to ask, sorry, I wasn't clear from what you actually, is it also a residential place or is it only day programs?
It is today, it's both. Thank you for asking that question. Shalva serves the entire spectrum of life, the cycle of life. As I mentioned, it began with one program. Today, it has the programs in the center from birth to 21 years of age. We then have, for our graduates and for others, independent, inclusive living apartments in the community. Each one has six young adults in it, six young men or six young women. And the number of apartments is growing steadily. The needs are tremendous. And so we definitely have residential. The overnight programs at Shalva are not residential in the sense that somebody's there every day, but every night there are, you know, extraordinary number of young people at Shalva. And on Shabbat, you know, you can have 135 people there with staff, volunteers, and kids. We also have a program which began at the beginning of last year called Rising in Rank for youngsters who want to be soldiers, have a disability, cannot serve in the regular troops. And we have a unique program, the only one in Israel. There are programs for people like this, but they're all 9-to-5 programs. The kid goes in the morning, comes back in the evening. We have a residential program. We are the army base, and that is becoming a very unique and very exciting program. They have an educational component, they serve, and they're moving into various units, and it's created great interest in very much a new concept. It's government recognized, government sanctioned, and so yes, we have that element as well. The other thing we have, which I failed to mention, is vocational training, where we train our young adults in extraordinary ways. They are working in almost every department at Shalva in some capacity, and we have courses to train them to be not chefs, it's called a chef, but it's to be cooks, so that they have the skills by the very best chefs, mind you, and they have the skills to go out and work in a hotel or other places where they can do something that is a value to them and of course their dignity. And when we talk about work, my son Yossi also works. He works at the headquarters of Israel's largest toll road. It's called Route 6. And he puts together easy passes. They're three-piece mechanical easy passes. And he has three boxes next to him, and he puts them together. And he puts hundreds and hundreds together in a day. He's an inspiration to the employees there. And when you talk to Yossi, somebody meets him. And by the way, if you meet him today and he has a conversation with you, and you meet him 10 years later, he will continue that conversation. It's often embarrassing because the person has long since divorced the wife he was living with at the time, or she was living with him. You know, he'll talk to him about his car, which he has sold many years ago, etc. But he picks up the conversation from where it was left off. His memory is truly uncanny. But in those conversations with many visitors, when asked questions, he will initially share that he works and where he works and what he does. And we learned from that the incredible significance of employment, of a person with disability being brought to a situation where they can contribute to society as a regular contributor. And that is, in my mind, what inclusion is all about, bringing a person to that point. And while inclusion is critical at all levels, I think the level of the measure of success is to what degree we can bring and enable that individual to contribute in his or her individual way.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Other questions, please? Yes, Greg.
Hi. I was wondering how many of your services or how much of your program is being shut down due to the virus right now?
COVID hit the entire country very, very hard, as you know, like everywhere in February, March, mid-April, everything in Israel was shut down for 6 weeks till the first week in June. And after that, it was opened slowly, but special education was certainly opened. And we've been open since then. And we've had periods when, you know, we did not have problems. And we've had periods, as we have had in the last, specifically the last few weeks, where the number of children and staff being hit with COVID has been much more sizable. What we have done is worked government order very carefully under their guidelines. And every employee at Shalva wears a colored bracelet, and he or she is allowed to talk to and associate with only people with that bracelet in their division. The reason for that is when one of them or a child in the class becomes with COVID, it knocks out those people, many of them with that bracelet, but it doesn't knock out 50 people as it would if, in fact, everybody was interacting with everybody. So we're struggling, we're open, we're pretty much at full capacity. This past week was especially difficult with, I believe, 25 staff and children knocked out. When I say knocked out, one has COVID and the others have to go into quarantine. So we're functioning, thank God, and you know, we continue to do so.
Kalman, can you share how Yossi has impacted the siblings? Clearly we see how he has impacted you and your wife. But how is he impacted, would you say? You know, again, I'm kind of stuck on that woman who said you have to take him out of the house. And how is he impacted on his siblings?
I think, well, first of all, factually, Yossi has had only positive impact on his siblings. We have seven children, may they be healthy. We have six at a very young age. And the seventh, a beautiful young lady, who is now 22, 16 and a half years younger than her youngest sibling, not younger than the oldest. And as a matter of fact, you met her, because if you noticed a beautiful young girl on the left during the Million Dreams in a white dress playing guitar, that's my daughter. And she, as well as the full Shalva band, are working professionals. They're not volunteers today. They all have the dignity of being employed, making their living with their music. Naturally, today it's a huge struggle. But I'll share a story that I think says it all. We were sitting at the Shabbat table, and my youngest was at that time 6 years old, and he's got four older brothers and an older sister. And the discussion turned to who is Yossi going to marry. And they were all kids. And one said a blind girl, one said a deaf girl, one said maybe a girl who has a physical disability. And the six-year-old Shlomi suddenly burst out in tears, crying and saying, why does Yossi have to marry somebody with a problem? He's normal. And for my wife and I, that was a major statement. You know, everybody was laughing. But it was a major statement that this is the way he and all his brothers and sisters saw Yossi. And it's very much the way the blonde woman in that 1 minute video said. She was in the pool with her child, and she said, I suddenly realized that I have a magnificent, beautiful child. And yes, he or she, I don't remember what, has Down syndrome. That the beauty is not in the disability, the beauty is in the individual, and the disability is a fact of life, which, you know, is not defining the child. Yossi is a gift. He loves his family. To him is extremely important. And yes, the children grew up differently. The children grew up with focus in so many ways. It does not matter how much parents want to help all their children equally. The child with a disability is always going to take first notice when he or she has a problem. And this was best expressed by a young girl who have a tremendous number of support groups. And we have one for siblings. And a 16-year-old said the following: my mother gave birth to my younger brother with a disability. We were a family of five. We then became a family of one. And when I heard that, I said, oh my God, that is the defining mission of Shalva. enabling that family not to be a family of one, because that child's needs take precedence over everybody else's, but to become a family again of six, where each of them can reach their own potential.
Wow, thank you. Tell me, when we go to Israel, how does one visit Shalva? What is the process in post-COVID times?
The process is very simple. Let me know you're coming. You know, lunch is on me. We have the best restaurant. You'll have an experience. People do bar and bat mitzvahs. We have a whole department that is now obviously not working of social events. People come to Shalva to do their own personal events, whether it be bar bat mitzvahs. We have ongoing events with, you know, corporate offices that come all the time. This accounted for 14% of our $20 million budget in 2019. Today, it's all dead in the water. And you know, we're looking forward to the day when that can return. But if you go on the Shalva website, there's info at shalva.org. You write an email, you'll be courteously responded to. You write me, kalman@shalva.org. And trust me, we'll make all the arrangements for you.
Wow. Thank you very much. Basil, please.
Kalman, would you share how your budget is made up? How much comes from the fees that people pay for services? How much comes from foundations? We hear 38% of your budget comes from the government. How is your budget made up? What is your budget made up of?
The budget is
made up. Question.
Pardon? I missed that.
I said a Basil question.
Basil has kept Beth Jacob afloat for the past 25 years.
Listen, when someone asks me those questions, he's a man of my spirit, because this is what I deal with every day. The budget is made up, as I said, of a $20 million budget today. 67% of that budget goes to pay staff. That is the single largest factor in our budget because of the extraordinary ratio of staff to child. 38% is today government. As a matter of fact, it might be 40, because with the changes in COVID, things have developed a little bit. About 14% was coming from the events department that we had, and the other is all coming from the private sector, from foundations, from private individuals. We have donors who are long-term donors and support us, and that accounts for most of the balance. And there is an enormous amount of work that is done by myself. Shalva has not large offices, but it has American Friends of Shalva sitting in New York with 3 employees. It has Canadian Friends with 2 employees, British Friends with 2 employees. So we have a hand to receive gifts in each of these countries, and they do events, and each of them has their part of the budget that is agreed upon that they are obligated, so to speak, to try and raise. And it's always very challenging. Yours truly in better days was traveling an enormous amount, as was somebody else on staff who was traveling to all over the world, basically. And it remains challenging. We are now at the stage, after 30 years, where our board is creating an endowment to secure the future of Shalva. And that is critical. And we understand that that is the future in terms of maintaining this organization down the road. But there's enormous confidence in what we've done and what we're doing. And as someone has said to me in the past, the mayor of Jerusalem, he says, Kalman, the reason you have donors is that they know by hook or by crook, not by crook, that's an expression, you will get the job done. You're not going to give up. And I said to him, you know what, that's a gift that playing sports puts into you, that, you know, you're going to do everything you have to do to win. And so it's a very challenging reality, but it's a very secure reality. It's been 30 years. We are on stable ground. We are very careful not to go into the red. And I do want to say that there seems to be a blessing here that keeps us afloat. And I, for one, believe that it has something to do with the fact that in 30 years, I've never paid a day late. Not when there was one employee and not when there's 450. And when asked about that, I always say, these people have to pay a mortgage. These people, you love your neighbor as yourself. When I was employed in the computer field, I expected to be paid on the first of the month. And sadly, in the world of nonprofits, it's not always the case. And I always say that I didn't build Shalva to in any way, you know, put somebody else in the lurch. So I sincerely believe that, you know, you do things right and there's some kind of blessing that keeps us going. But to say it's not challenging, it's every day, long days. I reconnected with many friends in Vancouver over COVID. It's been amazing. People I haven't seen in 50 years. And one of them said to me, he calls me Carrie, because that's K-E-R-O-Y is the name of my passport. That's how I grew up. He says, Carrie, when are you retiring? Because I'm 69. They're all retired, doctors, professors, lawyers, whatever they are. And I said, I really don't have those plans. He says, so when are you going to leave? I said, when they schlep me out of here. I'm enjoying every moment. Thank you.
And just to emphasize, there are no fees charged to the families. Is that correct?
No, the fees are like this. There are people are made aware what it costs us. So people know that this and this are the fees and the costs that we incur. We encourage people to help to the best of their ability. And people who don't have often turn to grandparents or whoever it is. And that accounts for, I wouldn't say a significant amount. Fees never account for a significant amount. But people know that they have an obligation to help us. But we will never take in a child based on the fact that they're in some way helping us or not. Tragically, in Jerusalem and in Israel, there's a lot of wealth today, and people always point that out to me, but there's also a lot of poverty, and people don't have bread on the table, let alone having to pay for sort of programs that do amazing things to change their lives, but they're strapped as it is. So yes, people are paying, but it will never be a significant amount.
Kalman, another question from continuity point of view. You obviously founded it, you built it, it's your life, it's your legacy, but is there sufficient people in the organization who will continue this indefinitely? Are there enough?
Basil, forgive me for saying it, I love your questions. What you've just said is something that key donors at Shalva are most at home with, because growing up in this family, I have seven children, as I mentioned, two of them, one is a lawyer and an MBA, the other one is a significant businessman, and the two of them have been involved in Shalva from early on. One of them today is the CEO, who he's the obviously the lawyer and the MBA, who is on top of things in a way that has never been a 9-to-5 or a 9-to-9 job. It's around the clock, day in and day out, with great passion. And his name is Yochanan, and people meet him and know him and feel like amazingly comfortable. Very accomplished young man. When I see a young man today, I believe he's 43. And the other one, Avi, is much more like his father. And he's been basically helping me for the last 15 years, and he is the public face of Shalva in terms of fundraising. He has, for example, we were faulted many, many years ago, going back 10 years ago, that why are we not raising more money in Israel? And Avi was at the meeting, and he said, you know what, you're right, give me 2 years. In 2 years, he had a major dinner for 1,000 people, and Israel now accounts the exact percentage slips. But Israel is a very significant part of, I think it's the largest single country in terms of fundraising with the United States in terms of what we're raising. So we have continuity in the leadership in an amazing, amazing way. And it's not only technical leadership where somebody will say he gets a better job somewhere else tomorrow or higher paying, because obviously for talented people, there are higher paying jobs in the private sector. So yes, the next generation of leadership is in hand, but again, it's something that is run and managed daily by, we seek out the best professionals in every field. Our finances are absolutely, have always been transparent, and we work only with the largest, you know, accounting and Ernst & Young, I was gonna say E&Y, in all our planning. So we work professionally, and yes, I believe the future is intact.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kalman. Yashar Koach to you, strength to you, continued success. You've inspired us as much as you are helping thousands of people and families on a daily basis. And for all those who are attending, I will send you links to the videos that we showed. And Fran, if you want to share any further information, you can send it to me, and I will forward it to all the attendees. And I know I'm looking forward to my next trip to Israel to having lunch with you. We still, I know we're arguing who's paying for it, but I'm looking forward. You're saying you, I'm saying me, but we'll sort that out. But I'm looking forward to visiting Shalva, and I'm sure all those also here who have joined us this evening on your next trip to Israel, make sure that Shalva is a stop. And let's all continue to, let's all be part of the bracha, experience the bracha, be uplifted from the bracha, and try to help with that bracha, to be a part of it.
Rabbi, and each of you on this call, thank you very, very much. It's been very meaningful, and I look forward indeed to hosting you in person.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank
you very much. Yes,
we'll let you go diving now. I know it's early in the morning. We got you before sunrise. So
listen, I'm up and ready to go now.
Thank you.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Thank you very much. Fran, thank you for all the organizing.
My pleasure. Shabbat shalom. All the best. Shabbat shalom,
everybody. Okay. Good night.
Good night. Good morning.